Elizabeth Warren, along with a few other prominent 2020 candidates such as Bernie Sanders, are advocating for hundreds of billions of dollars to be put towards the cancellation of student debt. We will go over why that's stupid, why student debt is stupid, why being a student is stupid, quite frankly, and how to avoid falling victim to it. Stay tuned.
John Doyle in. Heck off, Commie.
Hello there, pals and gals. Welcome to Heck Off Commie. My name is John Doyle, and today we're going to dive right into this one here. The way that I see it is basically there are a few problems, and we'll break down each one individually. Firstly, I want to make it clear that I'm not grandstanding on behalf of the boomers. Quite often, any criticism that young people have of the country is met by responses from boomers like, you got to work hard. You got to pull yourself up by your bootstraps, just like I did. And it's like, yeah, sure. I mean, but college was a lot less expensive back then, big guy. It isn't really that simple anymore, unfortunately. That graph, by the way, measures the cost relative to the consumer price index. And it says that since the early 1980s, roughly speaking, the cost of college has grown faster than the rate of inflation. But that being said, the solution to the problem isn't just to erase student debt, which, by the way, youngsters, is only being proposed because they want your vote. Maybe you're okay with that. Maybe you're okay with forwarding the cost of your degree onto the taxpayer. But bear in mind, eventually you will be that taxpayer and you'll be forced to subsidize useless degrees. And yes, I do mean useless. Everyone gets so offended and defensive nowadays, and they really shouldn't. And here's why they do. So we're told, my generation, Generation Z, the Zoomers, we're told that you have to do well in school so you can get into a good college, so you can get a good job. That's the plan. That's what we're told from day one. So let's break that down. Why do you need to get a job? Really, why do you have to work? You have to work because you need things to survive. And in order to obtain these things, you need to exchange your labor for them by earning money. Okay, cool. Makes sense. So that would mean that your problem is that you need money. Your problem isn't that you have to necessarily do well in school or that you have to necessarily go to college. Your problem is just that you need money for things. Our parents have told us that the only way to go about obtaining that money is to follow the path so you can get a job working for somebody else. And so we're so brainwashed into thinking that's the only thing we can do. We pick stupid degrees and then we get defensive when we're told why they're stupid. And here's what happens. I've been brainwashed into thinking I have to go to college in order to be successful. So I graduate high school. I get into a college. I think, which degree would I like? Well, I enjoyed my chemistry class when I was in high school. So I think I'll get a bachelor's degree in chemistry because I had fun doing chemistry before. No wonder something like 75% of students change their majors. They have no idea what they're doing. All they know is, well, college is my only option. So given that, I better pick something that I like doing so I can earn this degree here and make mom and pop real proud. And that's why they get defensive. You say, hey, getting a degree in anthropology is stupid. And to them, that's a huge insult because at that point, they think you're insulting their interests. They don't understand that the whole reason you go to college is to make an investment in yourself so that when you sit down in that interview, you can slide that piece of paper forward and say, hello there, Mr. HR. I know about this thing and I can apply that to your company in these ways. Because college is seen as a mandatory transition to adulthood. They think, oh, well, you know, I like that, so I guess that's what I'll do. If you're interested in anthropology or gender studies, you can read about them. That's what books are for. Like, I literally have like maybe 6 or 7 books on my bookshelf about gender studies, the history of the patriarchy, feminist art. It's pretty interesting, but that information cost me like less than $20 on Amazon because used books are extremely cheap. What does a college degree do? A college degree shows an employer that you're proficient enough in a subject to receive a degree from that institution, whatever it may be. That's all it is. You're not smarter than someone because you have a college degree. All you have is a certificate of your knowledge from a third-party institution. And since your problem is that you need money, and since you've decided to go to college and make that large financial investment in yourself, it does not make any sense whatsoever to get a degree in something that there is little to no job market for. It makes zero sense. You don't go to college to learn. You go to college to prove to your employer that you've learned about something. If you want to learn about art history, Amazon.com, it's the move. You're going to go to college. You need to balance your interests and what pays when picking your degree. To do otherwise is literally the stupidest thing I can think of pertaining to education. All right. So now that that's out of the way, actually, no. I despise the college experience while we're at it. I despise that some 19-year-old kid can spend 18 hours a week in class about doing, and then about the same doing homework, and then the rest of their time just going to football games, parties, getting brunch with their friends. I despise that person would have the audacity to look down on someone else for not attending college as if they're really being more productive than someone who went into skilled trades. For example, skilled trades, by the way, are high in demand right now because everyone thinks they're too good to go into them. You know who doesn't care? You know, the guy who went and became a plumber after high school, now he's making $60,000 a year the same time that you're finishing up your culinary arts degree. But yeah, no, just look down on him. And I don't blame it on them. I blame it really on the parents. Like, oh, our Timmy's doing so well at school. We're so proud of him. Yeah, I've got Timmy on Snapchat. Buddy spends his weekends doing keg stands and contracting gonorrhea. So maybe chill out on the whole, our son's the next Nobel Prize winner BS. All right, so actually, I'm going to say this now in case people don't finish the video, by the way. If you're a student, if you're about to become a student, you need to do what is best for you. Of course, you should listen to advice, but you should be able to distinguish when that advice should and should not be followed. There is no reason to wildly screw yourself over in the future in the name of appeasing the demands of your present self. If you want to go to college, go to community college for 2 years and transfer. Hunt for scholarships. There's something like $3 billion in federal grants that go unclaimed. And stop comparing yourself to your classmates. Since you're in high school, right? No one's really done anything. No one's done anything significant. So the obvious metric by which you can compare yourself to others would be the schools that you got into. But that's ridiculous. I know brilliant people didn't go to college. People that if I was like launching a startup company, I would instantly just hire them. They're just brilliant people. And I've known people, people that I've been friends with that I've spent a lot of time talking to that I've never heard them speak anything original. They're not passionate about anything, but they think that they're better than you because they got into a better school than you. I call those kids Zuckerbergs, by the way, because they're complete doorknobs, but they think that they're these ingenious kids because they got into a good school. They think that they're going to be the next whiz kid success story, hence the name Zuckerberg. Like, all right, just focus on yourself and what you want, but bear in mind that that's going to affect your position in the future. So now we can move on. I could go on for another half hour about that, to be honest. So yeah, kids see college as their only path to success. Parents don't understand that 30 years ago, you could get a really good, really well-paying job, excuse me, with a philosophy degree because it was a college degree. But now you're screwed if you had just that. So kids don't want to go to community college for 2 years and pay like $1,000 per semester because then they'd be missing out on the college experience, which is basically just, I'm afraid to grow up and accept responsibility, so I'm going to remain a man-child until I'm like 24. And I understand this isn't every student. Don't get me wrong. These are generalizations. If I'm not talking about you, you probably know like at least a dozen people that fit this. So student debt is burdensome to those that cannot pay it off. Like, if you can afford to pay off your debt, then it's not a burden by definition. Well, if your degree doesn't afford you that type of salary, then it's going to be a burden to you. But our government will subsidize the loan for you. How special. I guess dreams really do come true. Riddle me this. What incentive does a college have to not charge you $45,000 a year now? They know that you don't know about your other options. They also know that because of that, you'll go get a loan to pay for it. And now you graduate with an average of $37,000 in debt. That's the average, by the way. It goes up higher, but you know, mom and dad are real proud. So what happens? What happens now? You can't afford the payments. I mean, there are people with literally hundreds of thousands of dollars in debt, by the way. It gets up there pretty fast. So you think you're able to afford an apartment or a house or a car? Your credit's done. What happens if you miss your payments? The credit takes a hit. Credit sucks now. 34% of employers perform credit checks when evaluating a potential hire. The government will also seize your income tax return. They can also garnish your income, your earned income, for up to 15%. To help pay the loans, but it's fine, right? Mom and dad are so proud of Timmy. They don't care about you. They honestly, not your parents, the schools do not, the universities, they don't care about you at all. You can show up for welcome week, you get all excited, they throw free t-shirts at you, and it's all part of the scam. They're gonna let you walk out of there with a small mountain of debt. They won't lose a minute of sleep about it. Colleges are businesses, and you are nothing to them except a ripe fruit to be plucked. I have no problem with education or college graduates. I'm simply highlighting the problems with the culture of education and the educational system. If you want to fix this problem, stop subsidizing student loans. Costs will drop by the next semester. By necessity, I mean, according to the National Bureau of Economic Research, for-profit institutions that accept federal student loans have 78% higher tuition fees than those that do not. It's a smart move for colleges because, hey, the government guarantees that we'll get paid. Can you think of any other system that would let a 17-year-old kid take out $100,000 in loans, no questions asked? It's absurd. What are they going to do if you default on the loan? Are they going to come and take your education away? Apparently, my grandpa used to say, that's one thing they can never take from you, your education. But that was like within the context of being a POW, I'm pretty sure. But I don't know, maybe he was making a case for defaulting on student loans. Who knows? But it's not like you default on your car payment. They come take the car. No, their hands are effectively tied here. So we have more student loan debt now than credit card debt. Remember in Fight Club when like they blew up the credit card company's headquarters to erase the debt? Let's get an update on that one, Chuck. Apparently it doesn't fit the times anymore. And I don't think this whole thing is necessarily the fault of the students. I really don't. But the bottom line is the conversation we ought to be having isn't, hey, let's have the government pay for expensive college, but instead, hey, let's make college less expensive so we can just pay for it. And by the way, when the government pays for it, That just means we're taxed. It's just forwarding your debt onto the taxpayers. That's not right. You do not get to do that. You know, I mean, you knew what you were getting into. You consented to this burden. Don't make it our problem. That's all debt relief is. It just means we pick up the tab. Why should I have to pay for your education? I know why you think I should pay for education. Well, it's because you're upset and you want us to bail you out. But that's the honest reason. How you rationalize it, you say that, oh, my education is a public good. You think that since we're educating you, it's the same as how we pay for the fire department or for police with our taxes, and then we all benefit. I might be able to buy into this if we specified which degrees we actually subsidize, but subsidizing every college degree under the pretense of, oh, I'll benefit just as much from my taxes going to Stephanie's women's studies degree as I would from my taxes paying for people to come stop my house from burning down. Yeah, I don't buy it. The other argument is, oh, well, you know, making these investments in students will make them more productive and increase economic output. Like, sure, but that money being left in the hands of the taxpayers from whom you extort will do the same thing in the long run if left alone. So I don't buy into that one either. And what about the people that paid off their debt like they were supposed to? Doesn't that kind of screw them a little bit over? Are they going to be a little cheesed about that one? The problem is the system, and the idea that more government intervention will fix it it's actually like silly. Most of these schools, they pay no taxes. They're 501(c)(3). They don't even pay taxes on the football tickets they sell. They take in billions in annual revenue, and not only are they tax-free, they are tax-subsidized. It's a joke. It is a scam. It's a farce. Even Barack Obama, even he said it. I miss me some 2012 Barack Obama. Anything's better compared to what we have now. Look at what he said in his State of the Union address.
Some schools redesign courses to help students finish more quickly. Some use better technology. The point is, it's possible. So let me put colleges and universities on notice. If you can't stop tuition from going up, the funding you get from taxpayers will go down.
I wrote down some basic laws of economics. This is some highbrow, 150 IQ and above only type of stuff. Everyone else just trying to keep up. Number one, people do more of something when the reward increases. Therefore, when you subsidize something, you will get more of it. When you subsidize loans that enable schools to charge 18-year-olds tens of thousands of dollars a year, guess what you're going to get more of? Increasing tuition costs, big guy. Number two, people do less of something when the penalty of cost increases. When you remove the subsidized loans, people will be like, oh man, I can't go to college anymore. And the colleges will be like, no, hold on, we can work something out. And then tuition will decrease. Students can take out private loans, and even if their degrees are worthless by my judgment, but who cares what I think, they'll be far less likely to be crippled by the debt. Number three, the third-party buyer effect. Whenever goods and services are provided at zero cost to the buyer, consumption of that thing is likely to rise dramatically unless limited in some other way. Enrollments in colleges and universities increase rapidly after the enactment of the GI Bill, government-subsidized loans, other programs that lowered the price of education to students. Note, the actual price of education did not fall, only the price perceived by the students. The higher demand actually helped to increase the real price of education, influenced also by the must-go-to-college culture that we talked about earlier. Number four, the moral hazard, which refers to the fact that people tend to engage in riskier behavior when they are insured or shielded against the risk. Colleges are shielded from the student backlash since the government subsidizes the loans. That's another thing. I've never heard anyone get mad at the schools. They just get mad at the government. They're like, hey, you, fix this. Come on. And it's like the schools are just hiding behind them like, yeah, what? What is this? This is crazy. It's like when you go to the dentist and they're like, hey man, you got a bunch of plaque on your teeth, and you try and like share in the dentist's reaction and blame it on a third party. You're like, what? That's insane. What are we going to do about this? Anyways, number five, last one. What is seen and what is not seen? It's a phrase coined by the French journalist and economist Frédéric Bastiat. I believe it's pronounced in, used it to say that policies must be judged not only by their obvious effects, but also by their less obvious effects. In other words, hey, let's subsidize loans because everyone should go to college. Uh-oh, now the price of tuition is skyrocketing, but hey, at least we helped, right? High five, government. Yeah, we make everything better. Go government. Woo, it's, no, not really. It's hardly the case, big fella.
No, Bert, you need the chair.